What is your main objective today? What would you like to see?
I want to be able to pick him up and put him where he needs to go. It took me one time of getting him here, and I did what you said. He was flailing and wailing everywhere, and now he won't go near my hand.
So I did see in here that you said, I would like him to step up and being able to hold his feet, in parentheses, so he can't fly away.
Yep.
That's why you had that fiasco. We do not hold our birds' feet to restrain them, to keep them from doing something.
Okay.
We hold their feet so that we can interpret how they feel more effectively. And so that our communication while handling is incredibly clear so they know what our intention is. Meet Lisa and her Indian ringneck parrot, Rascal, who she has described as wild and timid, and told us that in order to catch him, she usually has to make him tired in order to do so. He avoids her so much that he actually sleeps on the ceiling fan because nobody can get him there.
See what I mean? Once I get him, he's fine.
Lisa's goal here today in class is to get Rascal to no longer fear going onto her hand. She made the mistake of holding his feet against his will one time when she got him to go onto her hand, and so she lost a lot of trust that way. If your bird is uncomfortable with it or has never been handled that way, sometimes it can startle them and make them feel forced to be somewhere. So it's really a behavior that you want to train or condition your bird to accept, not just expect them to handle it, and you definitely don't want to use it as a restraint or there's no positive reinforcement involved in it.
I'm gonna help her. You're just gonna watch her suffer.
He's like, what's in your hand?
Do you have treats?
Yeah, he's got them in his hand.
Now, unfortunately, you can see how timid Rascal is, even of other people, such as myself. When I go to approach with a treat in my hand, he immediately retreats from me and goes onto the perch that we wanted him on in the first place. And although this seems like, oh, he did it for me and not for Lisa, it's quite the contrary. He was avoiding me. Every single thing that Rascal has done thus far is to avoid something. And usually that comes from a bird that has just not learned the tools to overcome fear and associate what is a rational fear and what's an irrational fear. In this scenario, Rascal's fear is too high to want to train or work for treats. So I'm just trying to get Lisa to give him some space and time to sort of take in his new surroundings and just get to a calmer state. She really wants to work with him though and see progress. And sometimes that can backfire when the entire environment is just too overwhelming for the bird. One of the things we see people do with very fearful birds is they constantly accidentally bridge. They'll say, you're a good boy, you're good, you're okay, it's all right, it's okay. And they come from a standpoint of trying to comfort the bird, but usually they've paired a lot of those phrases or words with a bridge, which means a treat is coming, which means you did the right behavior. So the last thing that you want to do is tell a bird that they're being good when they're actually being anxious or fearful. You want to reward them when they're actually overcoming it or calming down, not when they're at the height of that emotional mode.
Okay, now you can ask him to target. Okay.
Do you want to see if you can get the behavior, Jamie?
I don't see a lot of food motivation.
So I'm gonna walk you guys through what was different with my approach to Rascal. Now, first off, we do not have a history together, so I'm more neutral to Rascal than anything else. His history with Lisa is avoidance. He's learned that that's what he does with her, is he just avoids everything at all costs. I don't have that history with him, so I get to start with a more clean slate. I do wanna point that out, that that's a big factor in our interaction together. I started off with first moving his play stand closer. That's because I understand that it's in his nature to avoid, and I want to make it easier to avoid me to something that is nearby and familiar to him. So I'm setting up the environment for which he feels like he can retreat and leave me. Then I approach first. I show him that I have treats, and then I present the target stick. And you can see that I presented the target stick low, whereas when Lisa presented the target stick, it was up high over his head. I feel like with some birds, they do not like having a huge human body and all of the different things that we have in our hands up and over them. We have to remember that parrots are prey animals, so having somebody over their head is pretty threatening. That's usually how they die, right? Is something catches them from above and just comes at them. So we have to be respectful of their natural instincts to not like that and make it an advantage to us of how we approach them. I also approached with lower energy and much slower, and I wasn't speaking. So this was a huge thing. Because Lisa already has an existing relationship with Rascal, you can tell she feels bad that he's so nervous in this new environment. She's doing everything in her human nature to console him, but as a bird, it's not consoling. And so it's actually working against her to add those variables of talking and accidentally bridging. When I came up, the only communication I had was my body language and how I presented everything. So I kind of took away all the variables and just worked with the bare minimum to be able to communicate as clearly to Rascal as possible on what behavior I wanted in order for him to receive that treat. This is what we mean by setting your bird up for success. Really reading the room and reading the bird and figuring out how to set everything up for that bird to be successful.
Did you say you eat like a grandma?
Yeah, because he eats so slow. His mom used to take her 45 minutes in a restaurant.
One of the things I notice about our setup is these dishes. I kind of feel like these dishes are a distraction and they're sort of in the way for Lisa to do what she needs to do. She points out that they come off, so we decide to just quickly take these off. And during that, Rascal ends up on Lisa yet again.
Choices.
So does he your mouth. So, okay. Stop. So you are leaning, which conveys what? What are you communicating when you're leaning?
I wanted him to know I wanted to get off.
I want you to go here. So then you add your hand.
Oh, okay.
What does your hand communicate?
He's scared of it, and he goes the other way.
And he goes the other way. Yeah. So you're saying, come this direction so I can scare you in the other direction.
Gotcha.
Okay?
So don't move my hands.
So stop doing the song and dance. We need to make it really comfortable for him to go here. You're giving too many signals.
Is there any chamomile tea in there?
There we go. Okay, so we're going to ask for a target whenever you think he's ready, if he'll come to the other side of the perch.
In this moment, Rascal is not responding to the target that Lisa is holding out. Dave's making jokes, which is making me laugh. So in case you guys think I'm laughing at our clients, I'm not laughing at their failures. I'm laughing at Dave. So I ask Lisa, what can she change about that situation to make it so that Rascal's likely to go for the target? And she suggests holding out the treat, which works perfectly. So don't get too hung up on being worried about using luring. I know that we kind of bash it sometimes. The only reason we would bash luring is if you depended on it long term, because then the animal isn't actually learning anything, it's just following the food. But a lot of the times, luring can be a very, very awesome tool for breakthrough moments like this, or getting the animal's attention, or getting them to overcome fear, because if they see that treat and they see that reward and they think it's worth it, they're more willing to do it.
This is a type of species that if you throw too much body language, they will just throw that much body language back at you.
And
you
guys will be like,
I don't know, it just got chaotic really quick.
Yeah. And,
right.
But if you slow down, they will slow down. Did you have something you want to say? That you can? It's appropriate?
No, I'm good. I'm kidding. I think this is where it plays into too much out of cage time, like we were talking earlier.
Right.
What it does is it makes it so a wild animal lives loose in your house.
Right.
But it's not, that doesn't mean it's a good pet, you know, but we can make it a good pet by being strategic.
It's okay, just stay.
don't.
By being strategic and really saying, okay, how do we have a great 30-minute interaction? And this is a really good example for you as well of like how much of this has been punishment, right? This is not a perfect interaction, but you can make it a perfect interaction by doing fewer and the value of the treat's higher and coming out of the cage is a higher reward, going back into high reward because there's the one of the two meals for the day, you know what I mean? So I think the too much out of cage time is a really important thing for people to pay attention to, and this is a great example.
There are a lot of great lessons here in this masterclass with Lisa. One of the things that I asked her to do is I asked if Rascal would target down her arm because I thought, wouldn't it be great if we could just target Rascal back to the perch instead of doing this whole song and dance? And so she said, yeah, I think that he'll follow the target. So she kind of put her arm out and down a little bit and she started asking him to touch the target. And the problem that I saw with that is that birds are most comfortable, again, prey animal, most comfortable up high. So he was very content on the top of her shoulder because that's up high somewhere safe where he knows nobody can get him or move him, including Lisa. So it's very unlikely for him to choose to go down and put himself lower and walk down her arm, which is something that I'm explaining to her. So it would be more successful for her to, or more likely for him to, her to be successful if she raised her arm and asked him to either stay at that same level or go higher. So that's just, again, another example of setting your bird up for success. What is your bird most likely going to do, and how can you set your bird up to be successful at what you want them to do? It's not going to be looking like this where you're asking them to go lower than where they already are in an environment that they're already nervous about. So something to definitely keep in mind on just how instinctively these birds think.
Okay, so there's a few miscommunication things going on again. So you asked him to target, he did it. You somehow continued to hold the target and want to deliver the treat and, gotcha, and everything, and it was just, the target was still there. So we actually tried to touch it a second time.
Right, I saw that.
During all that, your arm's starting to go down, okay, which communicates, go he that way.
Go up.
But you want him to go this down way. Okay. Yep. So just keep really clear, because it's all...
This is where, going back to the earlier analogy about touring China, how each communication needs to be super clear, and the more you can make that really clear. Yeah, he's going for it down where it is, yeah.
Perfect. Nice. Good boy.
Good boy. That's what it should look like. So when you make it more clear, you slow down,
yeah,
and you realize what you're asking, he's like, oh, I can do that. So let's do this again where we get him back on the T-stand, mm-hmm, and work in whatever approximation you feel like you guys are ready for.
Good boy.
So realize that he was a lot more receptive to that, right? Like this became easier because there was no more confusing signals.
Right.
So I think the clearer you are about everything, like he's going to get it and he's going to respond because you're going to make it the easiest thing.
Yeah, because I mean, he's not dumb.
Sorry. Let me see if he'll do it while I'm here.
It's okay. So if he's not receptive to that method, what method should you try?
Come here.
Good. Don't hold up a cue while the bird, you know, is not
realize he has food in his mouth. He's looking for it now. Will you come here for mama? Will you come here? Can you come? Good boy. Good boy. Give me a tiny one. Bite in half and tell where he's at.
There you go.
2 feet. Good boy.
I think we need to end on that one.
Yeah, just remember that the clicker is basically telling him, hey, your treat's coming. Okay. The treat doesn't need to be instant.
See, I thought it did.
Click, your treat's coming.
Okay,
cool. Gotcha. I'll let you get it.
Okay.
Here's my treat. Because I think that might be part of why you're going so fast in there, is like you want to be able to.
Yeah, I thought that I had to give it to him like right then. I just have to click right then.
Yes.
Okay.
the click needs to be precise, but the click is basically like, good job, that's exactly what I wanted. Let me get a treat for you.
Okay,
cool. I'm digging in my pocket or whatever that looks like, and I'm getting a treat.
So I don't have to try and be able to, because that's my problem.
Is you don't. You could have it in a treat pouch. So you could click and be like, yeah, cool. Here's your treat.
Okay.
It can take a few seconds. And I think that will slow everything down, because a few times that you clicked and then like surprised him with a treat, he was like, startled him. And so that's, I want all of that slower.
But look at this toy distraction.
I know. He's been busy. Super
cute. Loves
his
toys.
Yeah, he like destroyed that tiny toy.
So how would you say that went?
Terrible. Because I was the one causing the problem, not him. I mean, he knew what I wanted, and I just kept confusing him.
Really, my observations for your scenario is it's just way too much out of cage time.
Yeah. And well, and I know that. That's why I want to figure out how to get him in there. Mm-hmm. When I take him home, I will put him back in there. But I hadn't been able to catch him till last night. I haven't caught him since Christmas.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
What I would do is try to look at your scenario, and you have the knowledge. I've heard you repeating it. I've heard you see things that nobody else saw. You know, it's up here, so how do we put that into practice?
Right.
And I think one of the most effective ways I can help people recover their lost birds, for example, is to remove all emotion and pretend you're helping me find my bird. It's your African gray in the tree, but pretend it's mine.
Okay.
And as hard as that is, you detach yourself from the emotion, you can think logically. And I think that that's something where a lot of parrot owners struggle, is we try to put all this emotion instead of just, what are the facts? Boom, 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 boom. Let's deal with that.
And there's a lot going on. You got a lot more body language to dissect and analyze than anybody else at the class today. So you have a lot more to read. That's why I'm like, oh, if you slow down, you'll be able to catch it all and interpret it all. But if you go fast, we're all going to be like, I don't know, he just got scared and left.
Yeah.
I think you'll also not feel the pressure when we're not all surrounding you in a small room. You know what
right?
I mean? I think what we see here is not an accurate representation of how you do train. I do see that based on what you've said, how you answer things.
Yeah.
You know, so I think we can look at that and be like, okay, that's what it looked like today, but that's not probably your norm.
Right, no.
But with that being said, we just want to make sure you have those tools to go forward. And, and it's good for us to see what failure points look like, to be honest. Like,
exactly.
I'd rather see that than a perfect session, because there's a lot of things we can help with.
Yeah, and we got nothing to fix, so.